Good morning, church family. How nice it is to see all of you here this Sabbath morning. I'd just like to open up with a Bible verse that encourages me. And this is found in John chapter 14, verse 27. Some of you may know this one. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. And that just resonates with me, you know, in these days that we live in. One thing that we could do with more of is peace, and do not be afraid. I'd just like to leave you with that, and I'd like to welcome all of you. I see lots of regular members, and welcome to you. It's good to have you here. If it weren't for you, we wouldn't have a church. And there's also some visitors, so I'd like to welcome you. Pleasure to have you here, and I hope you enjoy your time here. And also a special welcome to our speaker, Bruce. We're looking forward to seeing what you have for us this morning. Well, I don't have many announcements this morning, but one that I do is there's going to be door knocking this afternoon, and that's going to happen at 3 p.m. So anyone who would like to go and do that, and Marianne's keen to have as many as possible, please meet at 3 p.m. in the holder room. And also, if you're not keen on going to the doors and knocking, but you would like to pray, they would really love to have a team there in the holder room sending up prayers as they go out and do that. Also, there's practice this afternoon for the regional day. If you are going to be in the orchestra, can you please meet at 3 p.m.? And also there's a practice for the choir at 4 p.m. So those of you who are involved, or if you'd like to be involved, please turn up for that. Right, could I get Judy to come up and make an announcement?
Happy Sabbath, everybody. I just wanted to give you a little bit of an update on the donation tax summaries. I was all ready to print them at the beginning of this week, and then I contacted the conference just to make sure I had everything right, and they discovered that there were some issues with the GST stemming back several years. So I've been working on that all week, and during that time the division discovered they had some errors in their system as well, which also delayed. I can't do anything until they've got their stuff fixed. But I promise you, as soon as all the errors are fixed, within 24 hours, I will have them out to you. We're getting there, but it's just been very, very slow. Thank you so much for your patience.
Thank you, Judy. There's certain jobs in the church which not many people put their hands up for, and treasurer is probably one of them, but you're doing a fantastic job, and we just thank you for that. Right, I just would also like to announce that there is a CAP money course. Okay, so for those of you who would like to be better with their money, please come along to that. That's been held in the holder room. And the dates for them are May 15th, 22nd, 29th. And they go from 7 to 8:30. So if you'd like to be involved with that, please come along. And also, I'm sure all of you have the bulletin here. So all these announcements are in the bulletin. So please check that out. And Fiona's going to come up and do memberships.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. So we have quite a few membership transfers this morning. So this is the first reading for membership transfers in for Cheryl Henderin, who is transferring in from Duggarville Seventh-day Adventist Church. We also have Maureen Casalet, who's transferring in from Papatoetoe Seventh-day Adventist Church. Demi Bayron, who's transferring in from Balud Seventh-day Adventist Church in the Philippines. Seriana Kong, who's transferring in from Navesau Adventist High School in Fiji. We also have Willie Kong, who's transferring in from Nondonumai Seventh-day Adventist Church in Fiji. We also have Tapiwa Mushaninga, who's transferring in from Selborne Park Seventh-day Adventist Church in Zimbabwe. And lastly, Shem Otieno, who is transferring in from Sare Seventh-day Adventist Church in Kenya. So these names will be on the table for 1 week. And if you have any questions or any concerns, please feel free to see the chairman, Pastor Justin. We also have transfers out. So this is the first reading for membership transfers out for Hilton Bryce Hutchins, who is transferring to Duggarville Seventh-day Adventist Church, and Tracy Mafilio, who is transferring to Mosaic Seventh-day Adventist Church Company. These names will also be on the table for 1 week. So if you have any questions or any concerns, please feel free to see the chairman, Pastor Justin. Thank you.
Thank you, Fiona. Now, so great to have so many people transferring in and all over from the world too. So what a blessing to have those people here in Palmy. Now, I'd like you all just to bow your heads where you are, and we'll just invite the Holy Spirit to be with us. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you that that we can come here and that we can meet like this. And as we do, Lord, I pray that that you will just be here with us, send your Holy Spirit to be with us and fill this room. Lord, I pray that you be with those who are leading out today. Be with those hearts and souls that are here in the pews, and also those watching online. We ask these things in your precious name. Amen. I'll invite the song service team to come up.
All right. Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath. God is good and all the time. I like that. So here is Babe, our pianist, and Kelvin is in the organist. So I would like you to stand with us in the first song as we sing along, so that we can bring back the glory and honor and praise to our Almighty God. So please all stand and sing, All Heal the Power of Jesus' Name.
His grace and crown him, Lord.
Church. Please be seated. Thank you.
And for our next hymn, Jesus Paid It All.
It's now come time to seek the Lord in prayer, so I'd invite those of you who can to join me in kneeling. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to come to you this morning in thanks and praise, in wonder and awe of your mighty power, Lord. Lord, we see it in everything around us. We see it in the flowers and the trees and your creation. But Lord, I also see it in my own life, just in the little things. And Lord, I just want to give you praise for that. Lord, I just want to thank you for everyone that has come in here today, every knee that is bowed, every knee that is kneeling and head that is bowed, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for them and that they are here, and Lord, I pray that their hearts will be opened and that the service today will just be a real blessing upon them. Lord, I pray for those who haven't been able to make it here today. Maybe they're discouraged. Maybe they're not physically able to be here. And Lord, I just pray that your spirit will be with them and you'll encourage them, and Lord, that they might be here with us again another day. Lord, I pray for those who are watching online, and may that be a real blessing to them as well. Lord, we thank you for the technology that can stream your word to all corners of the earth. Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, I just want to thank you for those who are leading out today, and I pray that you especially be with them, be with Bruce. May his words not be his own, Lord, but may they be straight from you. And Lord, may your Holy Spirit interpret those words to our individual needs and to our hearts, Lord. We ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
For our children's song, let's sing, "'Tis Love That Makes Us Happy."
"'Tis love that makes us happy, 'tis love that smooths the way. It helps us mind, it makes us kind to others every day.
It's time now for the children's story. Morning, children. Just wait for the old ones to sit down. Hey, you guys. Hey, Luan. Hey, Lucas. Hey, buddy. Hey. Hey, Logan. You gonna sit down, Logan? All right. Hey, guys. You all spread out all over the place. Now, I've got a little bit of a question, and Zari and Sabian can't answer this because they already know, but does anybody know what we did last night? We opened Sabbath in a very special way. Does anybody know? Can anybody guess? No? So last night, we had a house full of youth. Does anyone know what youth is?
No.
No? Youth means young adults. All right? So these people were between about 18 and 35, with a few exceptions of some older people. And we all came to our house last night. And we opened Sabbath together. And so we... Oh, Brooke, can you get my Bible? Oh yeah, that will be fine. So we told all the youth people to come to our house so that we could open Sabbath together. And when they all arrived, we had a little bit of a snack. I had made some nice bread and some broccoli dip, and we all had something to eat. And then we sat down, and we had a little bit of an icebreaker, and we talked about what we would do if we were in solitary confinement all by ourselves for a week in an apartment, and what were the three activities that you would bring. Can anybody say what the main thing that was that we would bring, Xavier?
Monopoly.
Monopoly, but that's not very fun if you play that by yourself, is it? You need a bit of a, you need a team to play that. What, Zari?
Bible.
Oh, yes, I've got the child of the award for the good child here that said, yes, the Bible. So the top thing was number one thing was we bring a Bible into our solitary confinement. And then we sang some songs. That is beautiful. We sang some songs, and then we prayed. And then we had some new youth come along that we didn't really know, and they got a little bit lost, but thankfully they arrived at our house, and we had a bit of another bit of an icebreaker just to introduce ourselves, because sometimes it's really nervous going into a house when you don't know people. So we went around and we introduced ourselves, and we said what we did for a living, and we also said what our favourite worship song. Does anyone have a favourite worship song? Well, you're all very quiet this morning. Cairo. Lord's Army. Wonderful, yes. So we did that. Felix, can I guess yours? Jesus Loves Me. Is that your favourite worship? Yes, I got that right. All right. And so we had, found out what everyone's worship songs were. And then we broke off into little groups, and Mr. Brooke gave us all different Bible stories that we could read and have a little bit of a ponder over. And these are really crazy Bible stories that you don't really understand what they mean. But we tried to gather what God was trying to do for us then, and how we could glorify God in those stories. And so we had a little bit of a conversation with our little groups, and then we came back to the main group, and we talked about that. And so then we had some hot chocolates, and then we had a prayer, and then we just had a little bit of a mingle time. And so the importance of my story is you little children that are sitting here now, you guys are going to be youth soon. Nafatali and Brian, you guys are going to be youth pretty soon, aren't you? So it's really important that you guys connect with your youth group in church, okay? We need to make sure that our church family know that there is youth leaders in our church, and that there will always be youth leaders in our church, and they are there to help you through this time. They're here to help you through to go through your youthful ages, which is a really, really hard time for you as growing up, that it's a really, really easy time for the world to get you. And so as youth leaders in our church, we really need to hold on to our children at this age, and we need to teach them really good foundations. And so Mr. Brooke and I, we are going to make a promise to you that when you guys come up to the youth of 18 and plus, we will be a safe place for you all. We want you guys to come and hang out at our house. We've built a pretty big, sturdy house that you can't really wreck too much. And so we want you guys to fill our house most Friday nights so that we can help you through. We can make sure that you guys know that Jesus loves you so much, and that there is no better way than Jesus. And so we want to make sure that we are your safe space. And there's going to be many other people in this church that are going to be youth leaders and that are going to help you through this time. So you promise me today, Nafatali and Brian, especially you guys, you promise me today that you will hold on to youth groups, okay? And you will make sure that when you're 18, you guys are in teens at the moment, make sure you're always coming to Sabbath school. Make sure you're always involved in your church. When there's a working bee, come along. When there's socials, come along, because church family is where you are safe and you need to hold on to Jesus, okay? And so I just want to share with you a Bible verse, which thankfully I can remember, if I can find it though. It's 1 Timothy. Oh, the pressure's on. Can you find it for me? I've got one hand. 1 Timothy 4:12. And so when you this age, you guys go to your primary school, Sabbath school, and your kindergarten Sabbath school, and your teen Sabbath school, and then you go into youth, okay? And then when you're a bit older, you go into the older Sabbath school, and you're always learning to be part of Jesus' family. 4:12. All right, everybody listening? Show me your listening ears. Look at me in the eyes. When you're listening, you're facing me and you're listening. Okay, it says, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through prophecy, when the body of elders laid their hands on you. So most of you guys will be hopefully dedicated in the Lord, and if you're not dedicated, you make sure you talk to your parents about getting dedicated. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Okay, so that's making sure you guys keep your hearts with Jesus Christ, okay? Wonderful. All right, thank you. You can all go back to your seats now.
Time has come to take up the offering, so could I invite the deacons to come forwards? Let's bow our heads, and Azaria is going to pray a blessing over the offering.
Dear Jesus, please help us to have a good day. Thank you that it's your holy day, and please bless the offering that's going to be given. Please bless the people who give the money and the people that don't have money. And please help the people that get the money. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see you here this Sabbath morning, and good to be here with you as well. Just waiting for this to come up on the screen. Oh, it is up there. Not on the back screen, so I was misled there. I just thought this morning I'd talk a little bit about Rahab. I like looking at people in history. I think a lot of what happens in the world is because of what people believed and what they did, influenced a huge amount by that. And Rahab is this lady. How many know the story of Rahab? Yes, most hands go up. Most of you know the story. You could come up and take my place. But Most of you know the story of Rahab, and it's a story of a lady with great, great, great faith. And we need to put it in context, when it occurred and what happened. And here's a map of the Sinai Peninsula leading up into the land of Palestine. And you'll know that when the Israelites left Egypt, they went down to Mount Sinai. You can see that at the base of the peninsula there. And then they go up, and you can see where Kadesh is, about pretty well in the middle. And that's where Moses sent out the 12 spies to have a look at the promised land. And the 12 go out, and you know the story. They all said, yeah, it's going to be a piece of cake, Moses. No. Two said, we can do this, Joshua and Caleb. 10 of them said, what were the excuses? They said, no, there's giants in the land, we'll never make it, and there's walled cities. And they were scared, even though they'd brought back one of the biggest bunch of grapes you'd ever seen. And I think in the middle of the Sinai Peninsula, they would have been quite, something to have, the big bunch of grapes. And so as a result of Israel's unbelief and lack of faith, you can see they go back down and they wander. For 40 years, they wander there in the desert until that generation all passed away. Very sad when you think of it. Only Joshua and Caleb, the two spies who believed that they could move, were wandering around. And so, you know the promised land, what was it described as? The land of milk and honey. And in those days, it truly was a land of milk and honey. It was a land, lush vegetation over most of it back in those days. The trees hadn't yet been all cut down. It was a land to be desired. And they're up there, they're close to this, and they're about to go in. Says there in 1 Corinthians 10, 11, we use this text like a generic text often to describe things that happened in the Old Testament, don't we? These things happened to them as examples for us. They were written down to warn us who live at the end of the age. When I went and looked specifically at the context of this text, do you realize it refers exactly to, specifically to this time period when they were about to go over into the promised land, when they had been wandering in the wilderness, and they were about to go into the promised land. So it's probably a very special text to use this morning. So the things we're going to look at were examples to who? Who lives at the end of the age? We believe we live at the end of the age. And so these stories were written down for our benefit. And the story of Rahab is one of those stories which is specifically for our benefit. And we need to remember that. Poor old Moses, he'd been a faithful servant, but he was not allowed to go over into the promised land. In fact, the Lord led him up there on top of Mount Nebo where he could look out and he could see across into the promised land, across the Jordan River. He could see the land of milk and honey. And it's up there that he died at 120 years of age. Joshua takes over the lead. Faith, a man of action, a fascinating figure. And he's the one who's to lead the children of Israel. When they look across, what did they see? Sitting across was the city of Jericho. And Jericho, the 10 spies had complained earlier, 40 years earlier, it's a walled city, we'll never be able to make it. Because in those days, walled cities were generally pretty safe places. If you shut the gates, and you had a supply. If they shut the gates and the army managed to batter it down, the general rule that one of two things would usually happen to you. You'd either be killed, which wasn't terribly pleasant, or you'd be sold off into slavery, which was equally pretty. You were going to shut the gates and hold out. You had to be pretty certain that you were going to be successful in holding out the besieging army. And Joshua and the Israelites could look across and they could see this walled city, which was very strongly walled. You are going to be the children across. Is there Joshua, son of Nun, secretly sent out from Shittim, two men as spies? Go look over the land, check out Jericho. Cute. If they'd gone back and Joshua said, where did you stay the night? They probably would have had some red faces. Luckily, Josephus tells us a little bit more about the situation. He says that Rahab owned an inn in the city wall. And so they go in and they stay at the most logical place. So she had an inn, she was an innkeeper, and as well as that, she had a secondary business going there as well, which was well known to the locals. And so they go, but we also get told that their names supposedly were Phinehas and Caleb. And they posed themselves as sellers of pottery. So they turn up, they stay at the local inn right by the city gate in the city wall, pretending that they're sellers of pottery. They probably would sell a bit along the way so that their cover's not broken. And they there meet Rahab, who was, we're told, a very, very beautiful woman. In fact, according to Jewish tradition, she was one of the four most beautiful women in the ancient world. There you go. Four most beautiful Jewish women, should I say. And you know the other three, don't you? Don't you? Sarah? Esther? Abigail? And Rahab were regarded as the four most beautiful women in the ancient Jewish world. And so there they meet her, but it's not too long before the king of Jericho hears, somebody whispers to him, and he says, there's some men come in, they're strange men, we don't know where they're from, and they're gone to stay in Rahab's house. So he sends other men down there to say, you know, I want to know who those men are, you need to send them to me. And he sends some strong men along, and this is where Rahab does something which we always had a bit of trouble with this. What does she do? She tells a lie. And she says, no, they've just left. If you're quick, you might find them. They've just gone out the city gate. Won't be far away. And the men who go down there buy the lie, and out they go through the gate to try and catch these two men when all the time they're in Rahab's house. I don't know, when I was young, my mother used to always line us up and tell us, under no circumstances are you ever to tell a lie. Never, never, never tell a lie. And I know my grandfather used to lay it on the line with her. There were 14 children in her family. From death. She knew that the walls and the gates were not going to hold out, and that if the Israelites got in there, that it was death for all of them, or slavery. Our lives for yours, said the men, but don't tell anyone our business. When God turns this land over to us, we'll do right by you in loyal mercy. So she extracts a promise from them, a pretty wise thing to do. And so she then, when it's dark, lets them out down through a window. She was in the wall, lets them out down through the window down to the ground below. But she says to them before they go, she says, don't head east towards where the children of Israel are. Go to the west. Hide in the hills, which are up behind Jericho there. Wait a couple of days, then make your way back to the Israelite camp. And as a result, they did exactly that. They go up into the hills behind Jericho, hide out, and they wait until the dust is blowing over a little bit, and then they go back and they cross the Jordan. I don't know how they crossed the Jordan, whether they had a boat or they swam or whatever it was, but they got back. And when they got back, they met with Joshua and they said, they told Joshua, yes, God has given the whole country to us. Everybody there is in a state of panic because of us. Little different to the 10 spies 40 years earlier, isn't it? I wonder that's why Joshua just sent two. Thought if he sent another dozen over, maybe there'd be a little bit more dissension. And I think he would have chosen Phinehas and Caleb pretty well before he sent them out. He knew these were people he could trust, that they were people of faith. And when you read through how the Lord appears to Joshua and gives him the instructions of what he is to do, quite incredible things happen. And the Jordan in those days was a much bigger river than it is today. With all the vegetation, with all the rainfall, there was a lot more water. They estimate that it was 30 metres deep at that point where they were going to cross over. 30 metres is quite a deep river. But he says, you know, you're to go forward in faith, the priests are to go, they are to step into the river, and when they step into the river, the water will pile up. And then when it's stopped and there's dry land there, then the children of Israel are to go across. And it's exactly what happened. You can imagine the effect on the children of Israel when the priests set out. I would have bet there were a few of them are going, I wonder whether this will work. But when the priests stepped into the river and the water banked up, it stopped flowing. It was near a town called Adam, we're told. And people in the town of Adam saw what was happening. I think they're probably able to look over the wall of their town and go, come and look at this. And they saw all the children of Israel go across on dry land. They saw Joshua command men to go and get 12 stones, large stones, to build a monument to that happening. And they were witnesses. You probably couldn't have seen it from Jericho, but it didn't take long for the people of Jericho to hear about it. I think the people in the town of Adam got out pretty quick that night and went over and knocked on the gate and said, you guys need to know this, but we've just witnessed something remarkable. The Jordan stopped flowing, the people went across, and when the priest stepped out, the Jordan started flowing again down towards the Dead Sea. An amazing thing. And it says there, now, when all the Amorite kings west of the Jordan and all the Canaanite kings along the coast heard how God had dried up the Jordan before the Israelites until they had crossed over, their hearts melted in fear and they no longer had the courage to face the Israelites. I'm not surprised. I think people would have said, you know, they've got a God and he's on their side and we don't think you're going to be able to beat this one. And it wasn't too long before Joshua then starts with his instructions of what they were to do at Jericho. The people in Jericho still had faith in their walls, obviously. I don't think they had any much, you know, they couldn't do much else. They were worried. So they locked the gates up and they hoped that this would defend them against the Israelites. And of course, you know the story. If you went to Sabbath school as a youngster, wouldn't it? You would have probably walked around the room seven times and given a good shout as you practiced this. I wonder what happened on the first day. You know, they went out there. They weren't to shout. Only the priests were to blow on the trumpet things, you know, the shofars. And that was all. And they went round once. And I suppose the people up on the wall of Jericho were watching and thought, what is this about? The second day, the third day, the fourth day the same. On the sixth day, I would imagine there was a few of them think, what are these guys doing? Probably starting to feel a little bit more secure behind their city walls and think, well, it's a good display. And then on the seventh day, they go and they march around seven times. And on the seventh time, when they blow the shofars, everybody shouts. And the walls came down. You want to know the date? They tell me it was on the 20th of April, 1400 BC. I'm not sure. I won't say that with absolute certainty, but that's what the Bible scholars tell us. So on the 20th of April, 1400 BC, they shouted and the walls collapsed. And the city was opened up and the Israelite soldiers were able to march in. And if you read it, they didn't spare anyone apart from Rahab and her family. Joshua got the two spies and he said, you are to go in and to where Rahab lives and you are to secure that area and we'll take her and her family out. The rest were all put to the sword. And there was basically a real massacre when you think of it. And you sometimes wonder, how did God let things like that happen? Well, I can't really explain it, but there'll be a day when we're in the new earth and we will understand it much better than we do now. If you were to go to Jericho today, not much left of the walls. When they dug it up, this was excavated in 1907 by a German team. And when they excavated, they found this bit of the wall still intact. And they called it Rahab's Wall because it's right by the city gate. And it had, they said this is probably the only part of the wall that hadn't collapsed. So it quite well may be where Rahab lived and was preserved. And they went in, those two spies went in, and they secured Rahab and her family as they had promised, and they led them out. And it says there in Joshua chapter 6, it says, but Joshua let Rahab the harlot live. Rahab and her father's household, and everyone connected to her. She is still alive and well in Israel because she hid the agents whom Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. So that would have been written not long after. When you read through the record, though, it's obvious when they got them first, they kept them outside the camp. It was like, these are not Israelites. What do we do with them? But when we read, it wasn't very long before they were inside the camp and accepted as part of the Israelite camp, Rahab and her family. And it wasn't too long before there was a wedding. And Rahab marries Salmon, and she has a family. So they were quite remarkable when you think of it. And it's even more remarkable when we go to the book of Matthew and we read, Matthew starts off with the lineage of Jesus, doesn't he? And he says there, Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse, and Jesse, the father of King David. Rahab was the great-great-grandmother of David. And then we throw in there, we've got Ruth. Is she an Israelite? No, she's a Moabitess. Imagine if they'd had those DNA tests when David was around and said, David, here, spit into this tube. We're going to find out what DNA you've got. Would have come back and shown that he actually had quite a bit of Moabite, Amorite bloodlines in him, wouldn't he? He was not the pure Israelite that we often think of him. And so it shows you that this lady who had led a fairly disreputable life, God honors her for her faith and elevates her so she becomes one of the forebears of the greatest king of Israel. More than that, isn't it? We come down 1,400 years later when a little baby's born in Bethlehem and one of his forebears is this lady from Jericho, Rahab, as well as Ruth. And what it says to me is, God's grace can cover all sin. We sometimes think, there's some things that we could do maybe never be forgiven. That's not the case. God's grace can cover everything. He can use people that we don't even imagine. And he used these two foreigners in terms of being progenitors of both the greatest king and the Messiah himself. So, when in the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 11, you know the great faith chapter, don't you? And in there, the heroes of the faith are all listed. And when we look at it, you've got Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Joseph, Moses. Who would you put next after Moses? If I'd written that, I would have put Joshua, because he was a man of incredible faith and leadership. A great man. But no, who is put in there? Rahab is put in there as an example of great faith. Joshua is left out. It wasn't that they were politically correct and, you know, when they're writing the book of Hebrews, they say, well, we better slip in a woman. They'd do that today, wouldn't they? We better put a woman in there. No, that was written at a time when that wouldn't have been a factor at all. But Rahab earns her place in the chapter of faith because of what she did and the high regard that God had for her. And she was an outsider, an outcast, an alien, a stranger who by God's mysterious plan, his sovereign power and his amazing grace, this Amorite woman becomes an heir of his covenant promises. Nobody is outside God's kingdom if they choose to be inside and to accept God as their Lord and ruler. The act of faith is what distinguishes, this is what it says in Hebrews 11:2, it says the act of faith is what distinguished our ancestors, set them above the crowd. And that's what distinguished Rahab, set her above everybody else that had her mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. It says there, by an act of faith, Rahab, the Jericho harlot, welcomed the spies and escaped the destruction that came on those who refused to trust God. It was her faith, the same faith that you can have and I can have. I'm always, you know, as you read through the story, though, poor old Rahab's past always seems to catch up on her, doesn't it? They think they always refer to her as Rahab the harlot. A bit sad in a way. But she showed amazing faith and belief. You know, she chose to follow God's people. She hadn't done the vegetarian cooking classes. She hadn't had the Bible studies that we would expect people to do before we would accept them into the faith. And as far as we know, she hadn't even given up her former profession at that stage when she makes the decision that she's going to go with God's people. But she did read the signs of the times and made a conscious decision of where she wanted her future to be. And I like this bit, even though James has to mention that she's Rahab the harlot as well, but I like what he says here. He says, in the same way, was not also Rahab the harlot justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? In a way, that brought me a little bit of comfort because if yeah. How did she send them out by another way? She told a white lie, and I didn't know how to handle that. But it's James commends her for what she did, and we leave God to judge in situations like that. And James said, you know, she received the messages and sent them out by another way. Good news, though. I don't think when we get to the New Jerusalem that we'll be referring to her as Rahab the harlot anymore. If you get there and you want to find Rahab and have a talk with her, I don't suggest you go and ask, where's Rahab the harlot live? Because it says there in Isaiah 62:2, it says, your great victory will be seen by every nation and king, and the Lord will even give you a new name. You're going to have a new name. I wonder what it will be. You know, they used to name people in the ancient world according to their character, didn't they? Who was this? Jacob the deceiver. They'd look at what sort of character you had and then they'd give you a name. And if you changed, every now and then he became Israel the overcomer. But what the good news that we've got, you know, you're going to get a new name. And it says there in Revelation 2:17, when you're up there in heaven and we're going to have a white stone in our hand. On the white stone will be our new name. And I think it's because God has great aspirations for every one of us. What he wants us to be. Not what we have been or are. What he wants you to be. What he sees the potential for you to be. And he's going to give you a new name. And it's going to be modeled around what your potential is. What the sort of And when you're in the new earth, you've got eternity to reach that potential. We had a question someone said in the Sabbath school lesson this morning, you know, maybe we might get a bit bored. Eternity. I don't think so. I think, you know, there'll be so much to do. You'll be able to see. God will give you your name and you will be absolutely blown away by what it is. I know that. And you'll be able to work towards maximizing your potential, because God always wants the very best for you. And he wanted the very best for Rahab. He knew what she was, but he didn't want her that way. You know, the stories in the Bible, we often read them using what I'd call our theological glasses, isn't it? We look at them and we sometimes convolute things and we miss the message. I used to always enjoy, I was lucky enough to listen to Arthur Maxwell when he visited New Zealand 3 times, twice at Longbourn, once at Big Camp up at Ardmore. And I was just enthralled by what he could tell stories the way that nobody else I could ever remember could tell a story. And you could sit there and he could have gone on for hours and you wouldn't have cared. And I think we learn more from when we read some of these old stories in the Bible. Take our theological glasses off and just read the story for what it is. And I think the story of Rahab is one of those stories. We need to read it and just follow it for what it is. For what God was able to do with and for this woman. I love this saying, you know, Max Licardo, he's written many things. I love listening to him because he's a speaker that imparts hope. And I like when he said this, and I think this is one of the things that he'll probably be remembered for more than all the other things that he wrote, where he said, God loves you just the way you are, but he refuses to leave you that way. He loved Rahab, despite the fact of her life and everything. He loved her, but wasn't going to leave her that way. He had a bigger plan, a better plan of what was going to happen to Rahab's life. He could see that she would be one of the progenitors when it came to David and to the Messiah. And so his plan was much bigger than she ever imagined. And it's the same for you and it's the same for me. God looks at you and he has a plan for you. And he knows what you're capable of. And he doesn't want to leave us the way that we are. Because if we stay, we remain the way that we are, we're never ever going to grow into God's plan for us. He wants to change us into better people. And he wants to change us so that we can help others to become better people too. And so we need to remember that God's grace brings real change and can reach everyone is what we need to remember. There's in Ephesians 2, verses 12, and these verses could have been written for Rahab. They could be written for you and me when we think of the message that's there. And he says, it's written for the Ephesians, but it has a much wider application, doesn't it? It says, you were without Christ. You were utter strangers to God's chosen community, the Jews. And you had no knowledge or right to the promise agreements. That could have been Rahab, couldn't it? Not just the Ephesians. It's you and me. We have no right to it. But he chose us. You had nothing to look forward to and no God to whom you could turn. But now through the blood of Christ, you who were once outside the pale are with us inside the circle of God's love and purpose. I like the way Phillips in his translation has used the term outside of the pale. We don't use that term very much now, do we? And I don't think people really... In ancient days in Ireland, the area around Dublin was known as the pale. And that was the only place in Ireland where there was law and order. Outside of the pale was where lawlessness reigned. And that's the analogy that he's using here. And what Paul is actually saying to the Ephesians, even though he probably doesn't use the term himself in the original, outside of the pale. He's saying, you lived outside of the pale. You lived outside the love of God and the grace of God. Now you are taken in and you are part of his family because of his grace. It was written originally for the Ephesians, could have been written for Rahab, but we know that it is written for every one of us. God bless you.
What a wonderful message we hear this morning, church, right? Are you all blessed? Yes, we are. So we may all rise to sing our closing song, My Faith Looks Up to Thee.
Father, we thank you that your grace is so abundant and available to each one of us, and we thank you for the stories that we have in the Bible that can show us your great work in the past, and we pray that we will always avail ourselves of your grace. Help us to be gracious people in turn. We ask this in Jesus' name.